Well, we come around the Lord's table. Welcome to all those who are watching today online via our YouTube channel, and all of you who are here. So thank you for being with us today. So we come and we recognize that it is done. It is finished. No more debt I owe. It's been paid in full. Be paid in full by the body and blood of Jesus. And we're so grateful to God, aren't we, that he sent his only son into the world so that we might live. We might live a life, you know, that's not just some kind of shadow, but it's a life that is full, because Jesus said, I have come to give you life and life in all its abundance. So it's not some kind of, you know, secondary life that he calls us to. He calls us into the very best, the very goodness of God in our lives. Can you think about that for just a moment, how much he's given to you and to me through this body, through his blood shed on the cross? He's forgiven us all our sins. He has enabled us to be whole in Christ today because of him, not because of anything we've done. So we're going to take the bread together, and we're just going to give thanks to God for that. We thank you today, Lord God, that you have given us this memorial, this means of remembering all that Jesus has done for us. That he came as a baby, that he lived as a man, and really, really importantly, that he died on a cross. And he rose again from the dead, and he lives forever and ever. And we, this morning, and for those folks online, today we remember not some kind of historical figure or an ideology, but we remember a real living person,
yes, Lord,
who is our Saviour, the Lord Jesus. And we declare that he's alive today. And he is interceding for us, and he stands for us in heaven. And he has not forgotten us. We're on his mind this morning. And we thank you, Lord. We thank you for this reminder of all that Jesus endured for us, his body broken. And thank you that in his brokenness, he offers us the opportunity to be made right with God, to be whole, to be resurrected and recreated, and to become a new being, the old gone, the new arriving.
Lord.
And we praise you today for this bread which symbolizes to us your body broken. Help us now as we take this bread to remember Jesus and to thank him for all he's done. We pray all this for your glory, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
So would you like to break the bread? And just on the night he was betrayed, Jesus broke bread and he said, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy rains, unending
grace. As we come to take the cup then, let's reflect on how much he has forgiven us. If you're really honest with yourself, you realize what a sinner you are.
Amen. Amen.
But you also realize, as you take this cup, how much Jesus has forgiven you. He's forgiven us all our sins.
Thank you, Lord.
I know how big a sinner I am. And he tells me he forgives me and he loves me. And he gave his life for me and he shed his blood for me and for you, my friends here. So let's give thanks for this. Lord, you say that there's life in the blood. And that's true for any living being. That we can't live without blood pumping around our bodies. And yet you willingly went to the cross and let your blood pour out of you so that we might be forgiven. You gave your life so that we might have life. Eternal life, forever with you. What an immense thing you did, Lord, in giving up. What an immense sacrifice you made. And we want to say thank you, Lord, for giving yourself upon the tree. For your shed blood. For the life that you've given to each person that puts their faith and their trust in you. And so we take this cup knowing how much you've forgiven us. I'm just saying, Lord, thank you so much. Without you, we would be without hope. But with you, we have an eternity to look forward to, full of amazing, amazing things.
Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen. On the night he was betrayed, then Jesus took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me, that whenever you take this bread and drink this cup, you remember the Lord's death until he comes."
Yes.
And we say with the Apostle John, "Even so, come, Lord Jesus." Yeah. Let's take this cup, hold the cup together, and we'll drink as a sign of our unity.
The Lord has promised good. My hope secures. He were my shield and portion me as long as life endures. My chains are.
Jesus died, Jesus rose, and Jesus is coming back. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever.
Amen. Amen. We're going to move on with our service now. If you were here last week, you'll have seen a play, an amazing play by John and Claire's life group. We're going to, just in case you couldn't remember, you don't remember it, because we're going to do the next part of this story today. In case you didn't remember it, or in case you weren't here, we're just going to have a little reminder. And then right at the end of this film clip, we'll get to where we're going to be today, because Paul lands on Malta.
Paul's journey to Rome, Acts 27 and 28. Paul was a prisoner in Caesarea near Jerusalem. Some of the Jews had accused him of doing wrong, so he wanted to sail to Rome to have his case tried there. Julius, a centurion, was in charge of getting Paul and the other prisoners to Rome. Luke and Aristarchus, Paul's friends, decided to join Paul on the journey. Paul's boat sailed along the coast of the Mediterranean Sea. At the port city of Myra, Julius found a grain ship from Egypt that was going to Rome. He transferred his prisoners to that ship. The winds were not favorable for sailing west, so they sailed south. The crew anchored south of the island of Crete, but by now it was winter, a dangerous time to sail. Paul met with the captain, the owner of the ship, and Julius. "If we continue this voyage, there will be damage to the ship, a loss of cargo, and possible loss of life," Paul warned. But the owner and captain wanted to sail to a safer harbor. Julius followed their advice. When a south wind blew, the sailors saw their chance to leave. Not long after they set sail, however, the ship was caught in a terrible storm. The sailors could not control the direction of the ship, so they let the ship ride with the wind. The sailors tied ropes around the ship to strengthen it and keep it from falling apart. As the storm continued, the ship was in danger of sinking because of its heavy cargo. The next day, the crew began to lighten the ship by throwing cargo overboard. The third day, they threw out some of the sailing gear. When the storm grew worse, the men could see neither the sun nor the stars, so they did not know where they were or in which direction they were going. Eventually, they gave up hope of surviving the storm. Again, Paul met with the captain, the owner, and Julius. "You should have listened to me," Paul said. "But cheer up. An angel of God told me that I would arrive at Rome and everyone on board would survive. The ship, however, will be destroyed. I believe what God has said will happen, but first we must run aground on a certain island." At midnight on the 14th night of the storm, the sailors determined they were close to land. They didn't want to crash on any rocks, so they threw four anchors off the back of the boat and waited for morning. Meanwhile, the sailors decided to save themselves. They started to lower the rowboat, pretending to attach anchors to the front of the boat. Paul saw them and told Julius that unless everyone stayed on the boat, they would die. Julius gave the soldiers orders to cut the rope and let the rowboat fall into the sea. Paul promised everyone they would not die. Then he took bread, thanked God for it, and instructed all 276 people on board to eat. In the morning, the crew saw that they were anchored near a bay with a beach. They let go of the anchors and steered the ship toward the bay. But the ship got stuck in the sand, and soon the waves started to break up the back of the ship. The soldiers wanted to kill the prisoners so they would not escape, but Julius stopped them. Julius told everyone who could to swim toward shore. Then he told those who could not swim to float toward land on pieces of the ship. Everyone did as he said and made it to the island called Malta. Since it was raining, the islanders made a fire so the men from the ship could get warm. As Paul threw some wood on the fire, a poisonous snake bit him on the hand and hung onto him. Paul shook the snake into the fire. The islanders were convinced Paul was a murderer and was being punished. When Paul did not die, they decided he must be some kind of god. But it was actually God's power that kept Paul from dying. Paul and the rest of the prisoners and crew stayed on the island for 3 months. During that time, Paul healed many of the sick and shared the gospel with the lost. After winter, Paul sailed to Rome, where he stayed in his own rented home under a guard's watch. Paul remained faithful to God, even though his voyage to Rome was hard. We should remain faithful to God no matter what happens in our lives too, because we know that God is faithful to us and loves us very much.
And then we're handing over to Andy, who's going to talk to us about that snake, I think.
About the snake.
The snake.
Anybody here love snakes?
Yes. No.
Love snakes?
No.
You like a snake, Joe?
Yeah.
Oh, no. Do you like snakes, Jacob?
It's a park called Farm, and he had a snake around his neck.
You had a snake around? Was it a big snake? No, just a little one. That's all right, then. It's a bit bigger. Oh, wow. You're very brave, Jacob, I have to say. I don't think I'd like a snake very much. And I'm sure I wouldn't like a snake that jumped out of a fire and bit me on the hand. You know, when I was walking through Anglesey not that long ago on holiday with my kids, as we were walking up this pathway, right in front of me was an adder that was all curled up. And it was an incredible sight, but boy, oh boy, did it make me jump. Because I didn't want to get too close. Because if you're bitten by an adder, of course, it's not lethal, but it is poisonous and it will hurt. So here's Paul then on this island. He's been 14 nights in a storm, in a hurricane. Can you imagine how tired he would be? You don't sleep in a hurricane, so I understand. Anyone been in a hurricane? Paul, when you were on the ship, were you in a hurricane?
Not a hurricane, but
20-odd foot waves. Yeah, you don't sleep much, do you? Because the old ship is going like this, yeah. Right, so there's Paul then, on this ship, with all of these 276 people, and I'm sure that Paul feels very responsible for those 276 people, because that's what kind of guy he was. He was a servant of God, he wanted to do the right thing, and he told those people that an angel had said to him that whilst the boat might be broken up, while everything might be destroyed, your lives will be saved. Now that is a massive statement to make, isn't it? How much trust did Paul have in God? So maybe that's our first point this morning. How much trust did Paul have in God when God spoke to him? You see, when God speaks to us, we can often think, oh yeah, right, okay. Yeah, okay. Well, what am I going to do with that? Well, I'm not going to tell anybody because, of course, I might look a fool. And I'm sure Paul felt often that he looked or spoke and people thought he was a bit mad, a bit crazy. What do you mean we're all going to survive? In this hurricane, when we've been in this storm for 14 nights and the boat is breaking up and we have to tie ropes around it to keep it together, we're going to survive this. But Paul is absolutely convinced that when God speaks, God delivers. And I just want us to know this morning that, you know, when God promises something, God always delivers on that promise. Because God cannot break a promise. And if he's promised you something and that promise maybe has not materialized just yet, God has not forgotten his promise to you. The second thing we need to understand is that when Paul was bitten on the hand by this snake, nothing happened. Nothing happened. He should have died. You know, and all of the islanders thought, well, he must be a criminal. You know, bad things happen to bad people, right? He must have done something wrong. He must have upset the gods somehow, and he must have been a bad man. 5 minutes later, while he's still standing, their attitude changes completely. Because, and I can hear Terry, forgive me, Marie, I know it's your anniversary today. Kept by the power of God.
Amen.
That was Terry's strapline, which I remember absolutely. He used to stand here and he used to declare it. We are kept by the power of God. And Paul's experience that day was that he was kept by the power of God. It was a miracle. Okay? It was a miracle. This man should be dead, but he's not. He's alive. And I know a God, and you know a God, if you know him this morning, who does miracles. Who does what no rational understanding can ever achieve. Okay, God is a God who is still today doing miracles. That's why we believe in praying for healing. That's why we believe in praying for deliverance. That's why we believe in praying that God will work out his purposes in all of the things that he has said and done. That's why we believe, because God does miracles. God changes people's lives. We know when he comes to live in us, we never become the same We're never the same people. We become a new person. It says, the Bible says that we become a new creation. You know, the old person that we once were is gone, and a new person, a new being, a new creation is born again. That's why we talk about being born again of the Spirit. That's why we talk about being born again of Jesus, because you are a new being. So you can't go back and live the old life. When Jesus comes into your heart, when you commit your life to him, how on earth can you go back and live the life you lived before? You can't. It's just not possible. Well, it is possible, because you can backslide and you can choose to do that. But you know, when Jesus comes to live in you, you can be a new creation. And I passionately believe that. And the final thing I just want to say this morning is that, you know, an angel of the Lord came to Paul and he said, you are going to go to Rome and you are going to testify and witness to the emperor. Amen. Nothing thwarts the plans of God. Amen. Nothing. Not even a snake bite. Now, I wonder what you think, you know, I mean, we all have ideas about what the snake represents, I'm sure. But even an attack of the enemy, and the enemy is often portrayed as a kind of serpent in the Bible. We know that right at the beginning in Genesis. Here's this serpent, this attack that comes and bites his hand. And God keeps him because God's plans and purposes are never thwarted. I think it's an amazing story. I mean, what on earth can you get from somebody having a snake bite? Well, you can find out that actually God is amazing. God keeps us even when things around us look difficult. God kept Paul through that storm and all the 276 people that were on board that ship because God said so. So if God has said it, God will do it. Please believe that. Hold on to that. Amidst the storms of our lives right now, amidst all of the world situation we're in right now, let's believe that God has said and God will do. Yes? Okay. I've finished. Thank you for listening.
Let us out of debt to you. up her eyes, lift up her eyes, we give her our life. We lift up her eyes, lift up her eyes, we give her our life. You alone can rescue, you alone can see, you alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find.